The U.S. Navy has finally acknowledged that videos appearing to show UFOs flying through the air are real. They don't call them UFOs, they call them unidentified aerial phenomena.
It's probably time to stop calling people who believe in UFOs crackpots, after the recent revelation that there's actually a Pentagon task force looking into them.
Since 2017, the change in the UFO conversation has been profound. Previously, for a journalist like myself, it was a no-go area. It was a complete taboo area. But with the New York Times stories, the various admissions that have been made progressively over the last few years by the Pentagon, that this is a real phenomenon, that it can't be prosaically explained, all of a sudden, the debate is changing. The paradigm has shifted. All of a sudden, it's okay to talk about the phenomenon. It's no longer ridiculed or dismissed out of hand. And that's profound. The UFO conversation is being stimulated inside government because for the first time in about 50 years, there are people in positions of power, people who've been on the inside, who are acknowledging the reality of the phenomenon.
There's footage and records of objects in the skies that we don't know exactly what they are. We can't explain how they moved, their trajectory. They did not have an easily explainable pattern.
Do you believe in aliens?
I'm absolutely convinced that's all there is to it.
Do you also believe that UFOs have come to Earth?
There has been and is an existing presence, an ET presence. And I spent millions and millions. I probably spent more as an individual than anybody else in the United States has ever spent on this subject.
Is it risky for you to say, you know, in public that you believe in UFOs and aliens?
I don't care.
You don't worry that some people will say, did you hear that guy? He sounds like he's crazy.
I don't care.
Why not?
It's not going to make a difference. It's not going to change reality of what I know.
Do you imagine that in our space travels we will encounter other forms of intelligent life?
You don't have to go anywhere.
You can find it here.
Yeah.
Hey everybody, welcome back to Engaging the Phenomenon, and today we have a friend of the channel and special guest, Jay from Project Unity. Welcome, Jay.
Hey James, it's good to be here as always, man.
Definitely, man. And you always got that awesome accent, so it's going to bring
if it changed
to the channel.
Suddenly out of nowhere, that'd be really weird. If it turns out I've got a really burly Scottish accent, that's how I normally sound. This is all just a cover.
Yeah, and my only concern is that I don't see the eyebrows anymore, so.
Yeah, the eyebrows are gone. I know, like some people genuinely wanted me to keep that, and I said that I would put them back on when I'm doing the Dream Team chats with John Madrowski and John Liu. I'll whack them back on for that because we're just having fun there. But yeah, I decided not to keep the floating eyebrows. It feels like it might have taken away some of the professionalism of what I'm trying to do. So unfortunately, the eyebrows had to go.
Yeah. So people watching now are going to have seen the trailer at the beginning of the video, Core Secrets. It's a documentary that has been in the works, I guess, for a little while. You're planning, you're putting together. Can you give us a framework for what the film or documentary is going to be, Core Secrets?
Yeah, thanks, man. It's been something that I've wanted to do for a long time because I enjoy doing video editing and, you know, I've done a lot of interviews. And after a while, I was like, you know, I really want to get into putting something together, a creative project that's informative. So obviously, I'm going to go down the route of doing a documentary style project. And it's been something that I've talked about in different ways. Like at the beginning of my ideas around it, it was going to be specifically about the Admiral Wilson leaks, and it was going to be a whole thing dedicated to that. It's now turned into something where that's being included, but because we've developed in the conversation over the last couple of years, it's definitely matured in where I want to go with the project. So I'm putting together something that I want to add another production that's got good production value, looks good, like visually is entertaining to watch and is informative and is not, as much as I enjoy them, because I do enjoy them, the cheesy UFO documentaries of the past with the sci-fi spooky music, and it's just, I don't know, we need to move beyond that. We've moved beyond that with things like The Phenomenon and other documentaries that have come out. And this is just my humble attempt to add something towards that and enjoy the process of doing it, because I love editing. You know, I did a degree in TV and film production, so it's something that I've always enjoyed. And yeah, really what I'm trying to focus on with this, because there's a lot of aspects of the UFO conversation that if anyone's listened to me for a while, they'll know that I'm interested in the nuts and bolts and the logistics and the national security issues and talking about that. But I'm also very much involved in the consciousness aspect of this discussion and the more immaterial and transcendental and abstract areas of this conversation. But with this, I wanted to just focus on the way that the conversation is being engaged with in the mainstream. So that is going to be more of a nuts and bolts conversation, and then adapt that into what is not being included so much. So we've had some reporting from the New York Times about the potential of crash retrievals. They spoke to Eric Davis, and it's kind of jumped into the mainstream media for a little bit and then gone. There's not really any sort of mention about crash retrievals or off-world vehicles being you know, re-engineered or reverse engineered. So that's the focus of Core Secrets, is to talk about the modern day narrative and then adapt it to incorporate the fact that there could be these very clandestine operations to reverse engineer, clandestine operations to reverse engineer this kind of material that's been retrieved over the years. And, you know, I've been lucky enough to connect with some very interesting people, some with intelligence backgrounds, some with mainstream media backgrounds. And yeah, it's just going to be a compilation of their testimonies, and I'm going to try and lace it together with as much entertaining and visually interesting footage, give it a good soundtrack, and hopefully it will be worth watching.
Yeah, it kind of reminds me of like the old school Disclosure Project stuff, but I mean, back then it wasn't like documentary style. It was just like raw footage of the people being interviewed, and you know, there was not really entertainment value to it per se. You know, it wasn't really tailored that way. But I had no idea that you had that background in the
I don't talk about it a whole lot, but since I was like 12 years old, I've enjoyed doing video editing. And for me, it always actually comes down to the soundtrack first, because I'm a musician as well, and music's just a big thing for me. And so it's always me listening to music and seeing a visual in my head of what would go well with that music that ends up becoming something like a project where I'm editing. And it always starts with a soundtrack. And especially with Core Secrets, I was listening to lots of different types of soundtracks and just building up the visual and soundscape for it. And that's just how it works for me. It always starts with the music. And then it has to flow well, in my opinion. That's just the way when something's put together with a soundtrack that complements the visuals, instead of it just being music, but it's synchronized and it moves with the visuals, it just has a flow to it. I don't know, maybe it's just me because I'm a bit of a film nerd and a music nerd. So I just kind of like geek out on really well-structured visual and audio connection, but it's just, yeah, that's important for me. So I'm hoping it will be that. It's 100% non-profit as well. And I have to highlight that, because I am going to be using things from open source on the public, you know, bits of footage, bits of testimony that aren't particularly things that I myself have received from people, but I'm using it to build up a visually interesting and also informative documentary. So it's going to be a good portion of it is going to be people that have spoken to me prior, you know, on the record that I haven't put out yet that are going to be part of this documentary. But it is going to be laced together with publicly sourced stuff as well. So it's 100% non-profit. I'm not trying to make any money. It's just a passion project. It's just something that I've really wanted to do. And it started to develop now to a point where I'm actually like, yeah, this is taking shape and this is going to be something. So I'm hoping, I don't want to give a definitive, but I'm hoping to get it out before Christmas. That's kind of my goal, is to get it done.
Oh, wow. That's ambitious, dude.
Yeah, it is. It is ambitious. And I'm not saying that's a guarantee. That's just kind of like where I would really like it to be coming out is before Christmas. But I'm still getting bits and pieces, and I'm still getting people who are contributing to the documentary sending video testimony. So if I can get into post-production phase by November, then hopefully throughout November I can start getting this done and edited out properly and packaged and ready for Christmas. But we'll
just don't release it on December 22nd. Because that's when the Matrix 4 is dropping. And
oh yeah, yeah, I'll make sure to avoid that. I'll probably be in the cinema watching it.
Yeah, right. But so the Core Secrets, people saw the trailer, they have kind of a rough idea of some of the themes, but what is something that you are going to really, maybe some main points that you really want to get across to viewers?
Well, obviously, you know, I'm doing this partly for the UFO community, because I'm a part of that and I want to contribute. But I'm also hoping that people who have never really, or have only just started to understand through the mainstream media stuff that's come out in the past few years, that this is a credible issue. And so they're just dipping their toes in, because I do actually find that quite a few people comment, or a few subscribers, or people that email me, who say, hey, I've just come across your channel. I don't really know a whole lot about the UFO issue. You know, I've only just seen the reports coming out of the past couple of years. This is really interesting. Now I'm watching your videos. And so it made me think, right, well, I want to make something where if someone is not in the UFO community, or if someone in the UFO community wants to show people outside of the UFO community, like family members or friends, a reliable, you know, source of information that they would find interesting. One, I think something like The Phenomenon did an incredible job of doing that, the documentary by James Fox. And so I suppose that's a part of it, is an inspiration of things like that. I want to put out more things that are like that, that are reliable, that you can give to people that haven't ever been in this subject. And it takes them through a explanatory journey to educate them on the core issues, the core secrets. And so it's going to, like I said, it's going to have that process of, this is what's been happening from 2017 up to present day, because I think 2017, we can all agree, is pretty much a landmark year with the New York Times reporting. And so it's going to go through that process of explaining that situation. And then I want to develop upon that situation with what feels like the easiest to integrate whilst still being very fundamentally important. And so most people know that I'm a big advocate of the consciousness discussion. But when we're talking about the national security and the bureaucratic handling of this issue in the government and the mainstream media, and the kind of reporting and the kind of narrative that we're going through, as much as I hate to admit it, I'm going to do a project dedicated to this, consciousness is like a whoo, crazy jump up from, you know, there's platforms in the sky that we don't know what they're doing, and they've got amazing capabilities and advanced spacecraft, basically, is what people would dilute that down to, having that then transition into the astral realms of consciousness being somehow traversed by a dimensional platform that might be a psychic object. I mean, that's a bit of a crazy turn to make. So that's not where I'm going with this. I want to go from that national security conversation, the what are they, why are they in our skies, are they Russian or are they Chinese kind of conversation, bring in some of the history to back up the fact that it's very likely not Russian or Chinese in terms of the wider conversation with the historical context. So definitely going to look back on you know, notable parts of the history of ufology and just use that to back up the fact that these ideas can pretty much be discarded in terms of the, you know, the overarching UFO phenomenon being related to drones that we might be seeing from foreign adversaries. But then also to integrate this conversation that, yes, they are taking this seriously now, but they've been taking this seriously for a very long time. There have been programs, there have been people that have been involved in programs that have come out and talked about that fact. And there are people within government or former that have actually been exposed to quite amazing things in terms of non-human technologies, at least what they believe to be non-human technologies. And that's a conversation that I think, as intense as it is for people that haven't heard about it, it's probably the easiest to integrate as a addition to what we've seen come out through the mainstream narrative so far. It's kind of the next logical step. The government's not going to go there willingly, in my opinion, but that doesn't mean that we should not highlight the fact that it's happening, because who knows who might watch, you know, the documentary or watch an interview that one of us does. We really don't know. I mean, all of us who are actually operating in the field of research and presenting like you and me, people do contact you. You do get people that come out and send you an email who turn out to be pretty interesting people. You know, so I think that we can't underestimate the idea that although a lot of people that are going to be watching stuff like this are already in the UFO community, one, there are people that are coming in that need to be educated in a way that's not going to put them off. And so that's kind of what I want to do with this. But two, there are people that are going to listen potentially that have the ability to push it a little bit further, or maybe it will give them the confidence to speak up about something that they know. So yeah, it's a passion project. It's something I'm enjoying doing, but it's also something that I feel I wanted to add to the conversation with a worthwhile documentary that just presents some of the larger issues that aren't being discussed yet.
Yeah, and this is kind of basic, but not everybody listening is gonna understand the reference. Where does the title Core Secrets come from?
Yes, the Core Secrets comes from the Admiral Wilson documents, or the Eric Davis notes. It's when Eric Davis is asking Admiral Wilson a few different questions about who might be running the program, or what kind of what kind of contractors are connected to it. The Admiral would reply, "Core Secret, can't tell." And so I've just basically used that term because, like I said, I am going to be highlighting the Admiral Wilson documents throughout the documentary. But I think it's also applicable. These are core secrets. These are, even if it's not related to crash retrievals, just the UFO conversation in general and how it's been treated over time. There was that document, and I can't remember actually what document. I think it came out of the Canadian Ministry of Defense, where it was talking about, and I believe it was back in the 50s, maybe the 60s, and it was referring to the fact that the UFO issue was considered a grave national security threat of higher importance than nuclear weapons. So, you know, this has been something that is a core secret and has been for a long time. So that's kind of why I chose to title it that, and hopefully bring out to light some of the potential implications of these core secrets.
Yeah, and I believe that's the 1952 Wilbur Smith memo.
Yes.
Where they're talking about the highly classified nature of UFO and UFO technology. And it's interesting, Leslie Kane in her book, UFOs, Generals and Pilots Go on the Record, Commander Will Miller in that book, she used him as a source. So she quoted him throughout parts of the book. And he actually was talking about that terminology in that book. And I believe that's 2010, 2011. And he said something like, core secret is something that if that information was exposed as like a detriment to the national security.
Yeah.
And, I think one of the questions here is, why has this been kept secret so long? Is it rightfully being withheld for the great benefit of the people, or is it something rogue that has just become a juggernaut unto itself and is now more self-serving secrecy than really it's just to protect people? So that's like a question that always comes up.
For me, it's like a little bit of column A, a little bit of column B. I mean, I'm an uninformed citizen. I'm just like everyone else. I don't know. Like, we don't know, do we? There could be some crazy secret that we just haven't even considered, that if it was told to us, we'd be like, holy shit, now I understand why we're doing that. Oh, wow. I have to keep in mind that there's that potential. Personally, I would say, now that this is being discussed, just say that. Just say, sorry, there are things we're not going to tell you because it's a major national security concern. And maybe in some way voice that out. And so let us know. People won't be happy with it, but people aren't happy right now. So I'd imagine that it's probably better to let your citizens know that you're protecting them than just to keep them in ignorance. And then they become frustrated when they learn that there's actually something going on, because then you're just going to cause, you know, a real disruption in how you're viewed by your own citizenship once they discover you're lying. So it's probably better to try and come clean in some way and skirt around it. And I think perhaps that's what we've been doing, right, for the past few years, like with the US government and with Lou and Chris and people coming out of the woodwork. It's a way in which they're trying to address it within their parameters, within their capabilities. And I think it's our job to ask tough questions and to kind of push for things that they can't speak about because of NDAs and because of restrictions. Like, they have to respect that. I respect the fact that they have to respect that. But I think that we also have to be able to ask hard questions and ask challenging questions and not let the conversations that are being ignored in media right now just kind of wither away and die and be ignored forever. I think we have to try and talk about them. So I guess with Core Secrets, I'm trying to create a representation of how I feel about that type of conversation and why it should be highlighted. But yeah, it's a difficult one, because like I said, we don't actually know, and there could be some really good reasons for not wanting to disclose this kind of stuff. But on the other side of that conversation, you know, like I said, I'm column A and I'm column B, because I think that if there is this world-changing potential, I mean, we're already going pretty fast down the drain pipe right now with like foreign conflicts amassing and, you know, tensions across borders and divides in politics and obviously a pandemic and people's response to that. And, you know, there's so much going on right now, climatological changes and, you know, it's, We need something to push us forward into a new domain. And I think that as a technological species, it's going to have to be a technological catalyst that comes through that, unless we change our ways completely, which I can't really see happening. So technology is going to have to be involved in the way we progress going forward. And if they're going to hold back technologies that could genuinely change the way in which we act in this world, I just think that they really need to weigh up the pros and cons of leaving this to the side. Because there's, you know, the cynical part of me thinks, well, they're just doing this because they want to have a one up on the Russians and the Chinese. And, you know, they want to keep an ace in the whole technology up their sleeves for whenever they need to deploy it. But then people who have intelligence backgrounds who've spoken to me have said, there are reasons why we need to have that kind of stuff against Russia and China. And I'm not in that community. I'm not in that type of situation. I don't know all of the ins and outs of how complicated counter-espionage and, keeping these kind of things safe from foreign actors is. So yeah, as a citizen, I would say that I think this needs to be an open discussion, at least within the public and the private sector. And by the private sector, I really mean the science community more than the private sector, the scientific community. Because this is a long-winded answer, and I'll shut up in a second. But, you know, people like Avi Loeb with the Galileo project and stuff like that, these are all really brilliant, admirable projects to try and find out the truth, but they're being sold short by not even, because all due respect to them, they're kind of looking at what the government's saying and going, all right, that's what the government knows. Now we're going to try and find some techno signatures and we're going to set up our plan. But the thing is, they don't know that that's not what, you know, that there's way more that the government does know. They don't know really about the fact that there are these programs that people like Nat Kobitz, the former director of the, you know, science and technology division of the US Navy, confirmed that he was read into multiple UFO programs. The fact that Admiral Bob Inman, years ago, acknowledged the fact that there are these recoveries and programs in existence. So, you know, it's like they're being sold short right now, the scientific community, by just understanding the narrative that's come out through the mainstream media and through the US government. So I feel like if we can get the academic, intellectual, scientific community engaged in that type of process, it might be able to put more pressure on the government. And you never know what might happen from that, but it's going to be a tough one. I mean, I agree with Richard Dolan. It's the red line. It's that part of the conversation where the government or whatever private entities are housing this stuff are just like, hell no, we're not doing that. We're not going to reveal that. And like we said, maybe there's a good reason, maybe there isn't a good reason. The problem is we don't know.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's an issue in a democratic society. We can't even make informed decisions.
Yeah.
Or, you know, yeah, so
that is a problem.
And, you know, and Avi Loeb doesn't know that, potentially the U.S. government already knows how to track UAPs.
Yeah.
You know, forget techno signatures. They know how to track them. And that's something that's been speculated through frequencies, neutrino light, and all that kind of stuff. I don't know how much, you know.
Well, I believe Eric Davis had a little something to say about that, didn't he? He was kind of he kind of said it wasn't right. I don't know if it's true or not, but I know that he said that he was kind of not on board with the signature tracking idea. I wouldn't be surprised. I wouldn't be surprised.
Yeah, I wouldn't be surprised at all. And you know, we have people that worked on satellites, like the gentleman Tyler from American Cosmic, who's a big satellite guy, and obviously I think he's involved in some kind of work like that, right? My speculation. You mentioned Nat Kobitz, and you had a bombshell interview with Ross Coulthart covering that. Do for the listeners, and is that going to be included in the Core Secrets
documentary? I think that's definitely something worth highlighting, so it'll be a part of it for sure.
And for people listening, do you want to talk to any of the Kobitz stories?
Well, it's an amazing story. Like Ross, I'm very fortunate to consider Ross a friend, and you know, we speak very regularly, and it's one of the joys of doing what I'm doing and slowly gaining connections, because it's one of those things that people say, you know, it's not what you know, it's who you know. And it is true. Like, you know, you meet a couple of people in these networks, they meet a couple more people, and so it was through James Rigney really that I met Ross, because him and Ross are good friends. And I've been talking to James Rigney, funnily enough, from the time where I released the first video way over a year back, kind of highlighting the fact that I do want to make a project about the Admiral Wilson documents. Yeah. And that was how I got in contact with Richard Dolan and James Rigney and a bunch of other guys. And so, my introduction to Ross and the subsequent friendship from that and all the back and forths, and he agreed very kindly to give me the exclusive interview when he was ready to talk about the book and talk about, because he's released his book In Plain Sight, which I'd recommend people check out. It's fantastic. I listened to the audiobook. It was really fun. And he said he'd give me the exclusive interview, and you know, it's very nice of him, because he didn't have to do that. He didn't have to. Other people did ask him to come on record, and he turned them down. And we had a very long interview. It's my most viewed interview on my channel. I think it's at 54,000 views now, which is huge for my channel. I mean, thank you. Yeah, my average is like 4,000 to 6,000, so 54,000 is pretty big for me. And it's a long interview. He goes through some amazing stuff, but one of the things he highlights is the friendship he developed with a man named Nat Kobitz. And he talks about how he got in contact with him and some other people. But Nat Kobitz was quite an elderly guy when he met him. And unfortunately, he did pass away not long after Ross had spoken with him and you know, got these statements from Nat. But he was amongst other things. And when I say amongst other things, his bona fides were extensive. His obituary is available online. I can, if you want, I can send you a link to his obituary. You can maybe put it in the description box or something for people that want to check it out, because it's definitely worth looking at just how insanely high level this guy was as a engineer and as a geek. You know, as Ross Coulthart said, the chief geek or the chief boffin of the U.S. Navy Science and Technology Division. He was the director of the U.S. Navy Science and Technology Division, and you know, had an extremely long and esteemed career within the U.S. Navy. And he struck up a friendship with Ross, and they spoke over time, not specifically about UFOs. That he was, you know, Ross was careful, and he was just talking about his Navy work and his work with the Science and Technology Division. And I'll just clear my throat. And so eventually Nat Kobitz says to Ross on the phone, "Ross, why don't you just, you know, ask me the questions you really want to ask?" And he knew what he meant. So, you know, Ross says, "All right, Nat," and, you know, asks him, "Have you ever been read in to a UFO crash retrieval or reverse engineering program?" And as Ross, recounts it on my channel, there's a long pause, and it's just the hiss of the phone, and then Nat Kobitz comes back with an abrupt yes, and Ross says himself he wasn't expecting it. He wasn't expecting the guy to say yes just off the bat like that. So he was a little bit stunned, and he had to gather himself together and asked him to reconfirm. You know, just so I can confirm, you're saying that you were read into these programs that were dealing with UFO crash retrievals and reverse engineering. And he said yes. And then Ross asks how many were retrieved, or how many did you know were retrieved? And Nat says multiple. So these are short answers given. I've heard some people say, oh, it's only just yes, multiple. It's like, okay, but he's saying yes, multiple in response to questions about reverse engineering programs and whether or not he's been read into them. So I think that's pretty relevant. And he actually said to Ross later on that he can't talk about much more of it, more specifically for Ross's safety than his own, just saying that he's never been read out of these, so he should probably shut up. But he gave Ross some brief but very striking answers about his own involvement. And there were some subsequent discussions where he acknowledged the fact that he was brought into a program. I can't remember specifically because Ross did mention whereabouts it was. I think it was part of the US Navy. It must have been. But he was brought into a program where he was shown debris because he was a specialist in electron beam welding, which is a EB welding, which is this really precise form of welding. It's apparently the most advanced welding we still have, and it doesn't produce the same welt of melted metal. It's almost seamless, very sharp, precise welding. And he was a master of that craft of electron beam welding. So he was brought in to look at these materials. That he recognized the metals involved, but didn't speak about what they were. He didn't say what they were to Ross, but he recognized the metals involved. There were it was kind of like this big bulkhead piece of metal, and he couldn't confirm if it was an off-world piece of technology. But he just said that he had no idea how it was put together. It went beyond his capabilities in science. So just keep in mind that the chief, the head of the U.S. Navy Science and Technology Division, who is, most proficient in our most advanced forms of welding and material bonding, had no idea how this thing could have been made in terms of the structuring. I believe it was layered again, much like the ones we've heard about, the micro layering of like atomic layer by layer. I don't know if it was atomic because I don't think he was able to do that kind of testing, but essentially, yes, like he was shown stuff that he couldn't recognize. But aside from that, he acknowledged to Ross that multiple retrievals and that, yes, he was read in. So, you know, I think that these types of people are really worth listening to, and I'm going to obviously highlight areas of his obituary in the documentary because it's worth people understanding just what level this guy was at. And he was nearing the end of his life, and I just think that, you know, I there's no reason for him to spin a yarn and tell a disinformative story, and that's not what Ross's impression was. And as someone who is, you know, fortunate enough to know Ross, I trust Ross's I've completely forgotten what word I'm trying to say. Judgment. There, yeah, there we go. I trust Ross's judgment on this case completely, and it's just an amazing story. So if people want to hear that, if you haven't heard my interview with Ross on Project Unity, you can check it out. It's a long interview, but he gets into some pretty amazing stuff. And he's at the forefront. He's one of those people at the forefront. I mean, he's got connections to so many people. It's ridiculous. And I think he's really doing the journalism proud and for this issue. So yeah, hats off to Ross every time.
Yeah. And, you know, that gets into the question, you know, this is crash retrieval week. So, you know, people are hashtagging crash retrievals, off-world vehicles, and doing content on crash retrievals this week. So that's appropriate to this conversation.
Absolutely.
What do you think of people? What would you say to people who are skeptical regarding crash retrievals, who say, you know, probably all the UFOs we're seeing are some kind of reverse, or they're just advanced undisclosed technologies, black budget technology?
Well, I think that there could be a part of the conversation that involves that. I think it would be disingenuous to disregard the idea that in the black budget clandestine world of, special access programs, that they haven't created, platforms using very exotic advanced systems that we're just not aware of. I mean, that could very well be the case. But I think that what we have to recognize is that this issue has been reported on in many ways for many years past the point of the Wright brothers inventing, creating our ability to even fly in the air. So, I mean, there's a whole spectrum of phenomena with the UFO issue. It's not just flying saucers. There's all sorts of strange stuff and, orbs of light, and it might not all be the same stuff. But what's pretty consistent is that there have been historical reports of what seem to be metallic solid body craft of some sort, or what we would understand within our modern lens as craft, maybe weren't understood then as craft. But my point is that there is a historical context. If you actually do your due diligence, which people like Neil deGrasse Tyson just failed to do, I remember him saying on Twitter that he had reviewed the UFO literature and was unsatisfied. As just like, I'm sorry, but you must be viewing it through the most biased lens that's about 6 inches thick and isn't very transparent, because there are historical testimonies and documents, government documents about UFO incursions going back years and years and years, way beyond the point where you could say it was Russian or Chinese or even American drone technology or any other type of advanced technology. Back in the 1940s, these things were happening during the first atomic tests. So, I think that, and obviously the 1940s is another landmark time because of the Roswell incident. So it's just one of those things where I think that if you're going to be really skeptical and say that it's all black budget, you need to have done your historical research and really looked into just how long-standing reports on UFO-type phenomena have been throughout the ages. And it is the ages. I mean, some people could argue with that, but it does seem to go back thousands of years into human history, the idea of unidentified aerial phenomena, which is probably better than unidentified flying objects for some of this context, because some of it is just phenomena, weird stuff that can't be fully quantized down to, that's a craft. But this is a whole spectrum of stuff that's been going on for a long time. So, yeah, it's one of those where I think that you can easily brush it aside if you haven't done any research into the history of UFOs. But if you have, then I think you have to be honest with yourself and say that it's likely to be maybe a part of the conversation, but representative of the whole thing, no way.
Yeah, and it's actually pretty funny. It's hard to take Neil deGrasse Tyson seriously. When he makes comments like, "Oh, it could have been a glitch on the technology or the FLIR or whatever," when they had already ruled that out.
Yeah, that's it. They're not doing the actual research. They're not actually digging into the pilot reports or the data that's come out. They're not doing that, and people just assume they are and put them on a pedestal and go, "Well, he said it, so he must have done the research," and it's just. Did you see the article that Bryce Zabel put out kind of challenging Neil deGrasse Tyson to a one-on-one?
Yeah. Oh, man.
He'll never do it, but I really wish he would, because I would love to see Neil deGrasse Tyson sit down with a distinguished researcher like Bryce or even Richard Dolan or someone else and just take him to task, on this refusal to look at it in an objective way, because right now it's just subjective bias towards what he believes to be logical, and his logic is being challenged. And it's going to be a really tough thing for people like Neil to integrate into their psyche. The more they do this, the more they reinforce, no, it cannot possibly be true, and I must be right about this situation. It's like you're gearing yourself up for a real shock when it becomes, in my mind, irrefutable, because right now they can still dismiss it because we don't have 4K, we don't have publicly 4K videos of UFOs and things that would be like, okay, undeniable. And the Pentagon hasn't released, craft or bodies or technology. So that's the kind of stuff that I think would probably convince someone like Neil. Maybe, I don't know, maybe we'd be shocked to find out that he would still refuse to acknowledge it.
Yeah.
Who knows how far down the spiral of denial that man has truly fallen. But I can't even remember what we were talking about. I'm just in a haze of being annoyed at Neil.
I just brought up the fact that, you know, he says things that have already been addressed, and he states that as the basis of his argument, which literally makes no sense. And it's hard for me to imagine, as intelligent as he is, that he's so blind to available information.
Well, I think that's the shocking revelation of things like this, right? It's like, really intelligent people can still be dumb as, you know what I mean? Like, we're not perfect. We have biases. Even the most brilliant minds of our time that we think are the most brilliant minds of our time, at least. Netflix specials and stuff like that, they're culpable, that they can make mistakes, and they can be biased, and they can, you know, be in human error. We're all capable and guilty of that in times of our lives. And so I think that when you're looking at someone like Neil or Steph Shostak or Mick West, it's just they're reinforcing their own bias. And we have people on the other side, you know, you have to be fair, because there are people that are so hardcore believers that they convince themselves of anything and everything. And that's just as bad. That's just as bad. You need to be objective. You know, we all slip up. I've slipped up. I've believed things because I want to believe them, and then it turns out, oh, maybe that wasn't really worth believing in. We develop and we grow and we mature in how we see these things. But we're all guilty of that. But it is frustrating to see it happen on the mainstream platforms, where people who are watching the TV think that Neil has done the work. That's what annoys me. It's the fact that, you know, he's talking as if he's coming from a place of absolute confidence that, you know, he's done that research, or he's really considered the situation. And even the most amateur UFO researcher can say that he has not considered the situation. And some of the most exceptional UFO researchers would destroy him if he went one-on-one with them on a podcast, you know?
For sure. Yeah. And, you know, and all this, you know, confusion, and I'm not saying this in a way to place blame, but it's because that people don't have the disclosure or the information that there's this split and everybody's confused. And, you know, again, it was really revealing how Eric Weinstein was reacting, because that's how scientists should be reacting. You know, like, what, this is actually real. Why is this not a more important issue? What the hell is going on? Academics need access to this. So I'm hopeful to have seen since 2017 where the conversation has gone. You know, despite maybe Neil deGrasse Tyson, there's been a lot of people, again, like Avi Loeb and many others have come forward. Michio Kaku was always pretty open-minded. Even I remember seeing an interview of him like 15 years ago, openly talking about you, saying like, why not? You know, it's eventually going to happen. So I think things are moving in a positive direction. I think more people are kind of open to the subject. The stigma is kind of depleting. And again, you know, there's that old adage that, you know, sometimes for like the new science, the old scientists have to basically die, and the new ones come with the new paradigm and rinse and repeat.
Well, I don't think we can underestimate the level of damage that a generational program of disinformation can cause. And it's not just disinformation coming directly from governments. It's just kind of like this weird self-inflicting problem that happens within the UFO community of disinforming themselves as well. And so, like, it's just, it got stimulated, I think, by government disinformation, and then the game just played out and it just kind of tumbled from there. And so it was on the fringes of society for so long. I mean, you know, in academic channels, which is, it's one of those things, it's unique. It's, you home in on a certain level of intelligence, and that's what causes this weird issue that we're talking about, where these people are very intelligent in one thing, but they haven't been taught to think in really abstract ways or different ways or ways that would contravene what they've been taught in their little academic channel. So as brilliant as that academic channel is for getting them into what they're doing and creating a profession and you know, causing innovation. Because let's be honest, through the academic community, there's been amazing things come out, but it also restricts them down to these very small channels. And so I think that we're really, it's going to take a little bit of time to erode away that knee-jerk reaction of flying saucers and gray aliens. And, you know, it's going to be a difficult thing. It's starting to happen. Eric Weinstein, Avi Loeb, Sam Harris, you know, people really, he especially, that's an important one. And I think they've actually approached him. He said that they've contacted him, but like, it makes sense they would approach someone like that who is a powerful speaker for the intellectual community, but also has that element of abstract thinking and you know, respects the metaphysical and the kind of transcendental in an intellectual way. And he's an important person for them to speak with. So I mean, it's happening, and over the next couple of years, I think that it's going to happen. You know, it's going to increase. But I do wonder where we're going to go with the conversation. You know, because it's not exactly causing headlines around the world. That's the issue. It's not, I mean, here in the UK, nothing, like really nothing at all. No, I could get 150,000 people and I guarantee about three of them would know what the Tic Tac is, the Nimitz Tic Tac. You know, I could bump into anyone on the street out there, they wouldn't know. So it's definitely not a conversation that's happening in a global scale. It's a very localized, primarily American conversation. And so, yeah, I don't know where it's all going to go. It does sometimes make me worry. I don't know. How do you feel about where it's going?
Well, that's actually what I wanted to ask you next. And I know it's actually funny enough, Tim McMillan had made a comment about, I don't know where he got the quote, but somebody said one of his sources said that like the UK didn't want to touch this, the UAP issue.
Yeah.
And, you know, allegedly he got that from some kind of high level source. I don't know if it's U.S. intelligence, but, you know, that's the concern, right? Is like we're getting this partial acknowledgement of, you know, something. Basically, it's very vague, probably intentionally. I don't know what conversations are going on behind the scenes in Congress and even U.S. intelligence. But there's that concern that there's going to be a partial acknowledgement and it's going to shut everything down from there. You know, they're just going to keep it as this mystery. And the real stuff is going to be, you know, in the classified worlds. So I don't know. I mean, I think that's the importance of why we have to press these issues and ask these questions and continue to keep these questions in the forefront for journalists and academics and other people to ask themselves and to clamp down on and investigate.
Yeah, I absolutely agree. And it's a weird thing. I mean, the UK, we're, you know, our government's old, like our secret keeping and our laws are old. We have a very rigid structure of secrecy with the Official Secrecy Act. And I think that we're quite happy to sit back and let the Americans talk about this. Let's see how they do with it. No reason for us to get involved. Even as a culture, we're like quite quiet and polite, and we always apologize for bumping into people. And we're just like, we're an awkward culture, the English. Yeah. So we don't have the same bravado as Americans. Obviously it's a generalization, but you know, it's just one of those things. We don't, as a cultural difference, I think that probably does resonate into how the government handles and deals with that type of information as well. And I think that it's a secret that in terms of the Western cultures, it's the Five Eyes, man. It's the trilateral Yakuza. It's, you know, signals intelligence sharing agreement that's been set up between all these little buddy countries, the Five Eye Alliance, and we're one of those. And America and Australia and Germany and Canada and New Zealand. I think that tapping into that information network that's been shared over the years is going to be a very difficult thing to do, if not impossible. So I wonder where the conversation is going to go. But like you said, and this is something that I've echoed as well, just because the conversation's going in a certain direction by the people that are speaking about it through government doesn't mean that we can't push and we can't press and we can't dig up information and put out, you know, presentations or conferences or documentaries or whatever you can to bring this forward. Like Robert Salas, you know, doing his presentation on UFOs and nuclear weapons that I'm going to get back to watching after we finish here, because I've been really enjoying watching that. And we were talking about it before we got on record. You know, these things are still happening. And we just got to keep pushing forward, man. It can be a tiring thing. And I think that's why sometimes I try and draw my focus to other things as well, because it can be a bit depressing when you think about how much needs to be addressed, just how much really does need to be addressed. And it's not, you know, we're very consumed by a 24-hour news cycle of frantic, you know, headlines, and it all just washes away in a couple of minutes. And we're a very transient culture. We don't really hold on to stuff for very long because we're constantly being bombarded with new information. So it's a difficult thing to get something out and kind of shout it without it suddenly getting drowned out by the, you know, the regular news and the regular headlines. And yeah, it's going to be a tough one, I think. But I genuinely do think that by pushing it forward as individuals, it does have a knock-on effect. And, you know, we can genuinely get to a point where we're having a more open discussion about some of the more controversial aspects, like the crash retrievals, like the retrieval of technologies or the reverse engineering of technologies, and maybe even one day the consciousness aspect. And I'll be very happy when that aspect of it is becoming a mainstream conversation. But I have to be a realist and see the fact that that's kind of a long-term projection of a conversation. Yeah. You know, for now, it's going to be the nuts and bolts, which is a necessary transition point, I think.
Yeah. I mean, you need the basic fundamental of this is real before you have the implications, and then kind of taking the other aspects of that that have been reported over the decades, at the very least. And, you know, yeah, it is a genuine concern. And it's hard for me, you know, even with everything that's gone on since 2017, it's very hard for me to imagine that they're just going to start acknowledging crash retrievals, even though there's been some like bombshell things said by Dr. Davis publicly, even to the point where, you know, Christopher Mellon validated that Davis gave a briefing, or he was part of a briefing, and that he told them where they might be able to find these programs that are housing exotic technologies and development. To me, I mean, that should be like, why isn't that being investigated full force?
It should be front page news. That should be front page news.
But and there is the Inspector General thing going on, and I hope that goes somewhere. But even if the proper chain of command and the proper channels receive access, because that's part of the big problem, is that the chain of command has been broken. The proper channels don't have even the basic information, and that's a whole process of them getting caught up to. And I think that's why we have the initiatives we've been seeing, and you know, the new task force stuff, and the armed service bill and stuff. I think that's part of a catch up. That's part of them catching up. Not even, you know, I mean, they're partially dealing with it because they're taking in reports, but you know, everything else seems so much deeper. And I would hope and assume that Elizondo and Eric Davis are trying to get them to do something with that. But that's such a big thing. And it's so hard to imagine that anything like that would be disclosed to the public unless there was another kind of, I don't want to say whistleblower, but there was somebody from within a reverse engineering program that felt brave enough and had the support, hopefully spoke to people like Lou and other people to do it the right way and be able to get that information to the right place where something would happen. But short of like a whistleblower coming out that has proper background and can be verified, it's hard to imagine that we're going to get there.
Short of a miracle, basically.
And Commander Will Miller, he said, for something like that to happen, it would take an act of God.
Yeah, an act of God. Yeah, And I think that was even something shared by the director of Lockheed, said something of a similar nature once, right? Ben Rich said something like that. It would take an act of God to get these things out. I mean, you know, it's that side of the conversation. That's why I kind of want to have it, though. You know what I mean? It's like, well, if they're not going to talk about it, I sure as hell am. And I think we should talk about it. And, you know, yeah, people in Congress have been shown, they have been briefed by Eric Davis on this fact. It's not like this isn't embedded within the minds of some people within Congress. It will be, obviously, if they've had these briefings. So it's there, the kind of flame of curiosity is kindling and glowing in a little corner of the US government right now. And, you know, I think that if enough can come out, then perhaps we can get enough oxygen to that to cause a big kind of blaze, to use the flame analogy, and create that interest. And it's an amazing thing to think that they do have those types of things hidden away from us. It really is. I mean, we spend our time embedded in this, but it suddenly starts to become just like, oh yeah, of course they've got technology. But it's like, if we really just sit there and go, they have technology that's not human, like, that's incredible.
Even possibly non-human entities, right?
Do you have the right to sequester away something so changing for humanity? I just don't think you can justify that under any national security auspice. I mean, you know, like I said before, I'm an uninformed citizen, so maybe they could change my mind on that. But I just, my heart kind of breaks over the idea that these profound mysteries are just locked away by a small group of primarily patriarchal militaristic people. I mean, like, I don't know if that's the best humanity can do. I think we can do a bit better than that, than to have these things under lock and key whilst we kind of just decompose over blowing each other up or ripping things out of the, or, you know, the earth and burning them for fuel. It's like, are we really this bad of a species? I have way more hope, because each time I meet an individual person, they fill me with hope. You know, when you meet an individual on the street, or you talk to someone one-on-one, that's usually when you see more evidence of humanity than when you look at groups of people doing crazy stuff on the news. And we all kind of get convinced by social media and by the mainstream media that everyone's just like crazy and there's all these divisions going on. But in all honesty, most people I meet are good people. You know, most people I speak to are good people and understand these issues. And so I think that it makes me sad to think that we've just got a few people that are in control of these secrets, and maybe they cry themselves to sleep every night knowing they've got really difficult things on their mind. I don't know what it's like to be one of those people. I don't know what it's like to hold on to a secret like that. And maybe there's justifiable reasons, but yeah, I just think about the potential of something like that coming out and what it could do for us. And I just think that, oh man, it really would be amazing if we were given that opportunity to grow as humans.
Yeah, absolutely agree. And kind of like the counter or the other side of that would be Tom DeLong was saying, you know, oh yeah, these people, you have no idea what it's like to be them, the way they live their lives and having to hold the secret, but they're doing it for the betterment of mankind. And
maybe he's right. Maybe he's right.
Well, but he was saying, and you know, again, if we can take with a grain of salt what he's saying, that this is, it's regardless of that, it is going to come out. Like, and I'm surprised by some of the stuff he says. I know he says some kind of like off the wall stuff, but again, the McCaslin thing is really,
well, this whole subject is off the wall, so it's up to us to decide what parts of that off the wall subject we think could be real. And it's genuinely, I think, for all of us a real challenge to be embedded in this conversation and to have all these different things coming at you, and you've got to try and filter through and decipher what you think is best. But like you said, General McCaslin, people that have spoken to Tom DeLong, the WikiLeaks evidence that's provided the evidence that was the case. These are big heavy hitters. These are big players, people that might know things. And Tom has said some pretty incredible stuff. So I don't know if I believe everything or agree with everything that he says, but I certainly listen and take it into account and keep it there logged in the back of my mind. And who knows, maybe he'll be proven right on a few of those different things as we progress through. I kind of hope not on some of it, because
yeah,
you know, some pretty disturbing implications, but there could be some disturbing implications. So you have to be ready for it to not all be love, light, and rainbows. I think that there's maybe an aspect of it that's kind of like that, but I don't think we can say the whole thing is just going to be okay. There might be some problems. Who knows?
Yeah. And again, without the general public knowing, it's, you know, you have no chance of seeing, you know, what the potential is for people to handle it, and for, yeah, you know, the potential to actually deal with the issue in a more appropriate way. It's kind of, yeah, just locked down on a very small group of people, very limited, you know, even the speculations or, you know, the ideas from, you know, the Wilson memo and other talks of crash retrievals is that you have a small group of people working on it that essentially can't do anything with it because they're just a handful of people. And, you know, instead of having the entire world or even, you know, academics within that country looking at it and problem solving, and, you know, it's so limited.
It is so limited, and it's genuinely a problem because we are a divided world. I mean, we do genuinely have foreign adversaries, people that don't want our way of life and we don't want their way of life. And that's kind of how it is on the global stage. So we do have issues. And I actually talked about this recently in a kind of little presentation I put together, just about different ideas for how it might go towards a more optimistic route, just through things that I'm observing coming out of sectors of society at the same time, like UFOs, psychedelic research, in tandem with artificial intelligence, because that's a scary conversation, but it does also have room for optimism within it. So I just think that we're coming to a point in time now where I think we're due a shift. We're due a shift in lots of different ways in which we think, and that's coming through science, because science is our kind of preferred medium now of observation and speculation. So through science, through advanced physics and quantum mechanics, it's being challenged by the very fact that there's something above our skies that seems to be doing things that our physics can't explain. And then when it comes to consciousness, which is pretty much the ultimate mystery, really. How are we even having this conversation? How are we aware of our environment? Like, what is that mysterious thing that is us? That's being challenged by the resurgence of research and interest in psychoactive substances and what they do to consciousness, and why some of them are actually endogenous to our own biochemistry, and our brains actually have these substances within them and receptors within the brain for them. So that, you know, we're learning novel, disruptive, challenging things in various sectors, and not even to talk about politics and how that's just collapsing and going crazy. It just feels like we're in this bubbling melting pot, a transformative moment. And you know, in this talk, I kind of compared it to a butterfly and a caterpillar. Like, you know, a butterfly and a caterpillar is a brilliant metamorphic kind of symbolic example to show of what's happening right now, because that creature it starts off as has to be broken down completely into its basic components and rebuilt back into something else that's completely beautiful and transcendental from what it was before. And I know it's a bit of a weird analogy, but I just kind of see it as quite poignant that society really does seem to be struggling and in some ways breaking down. And perhaps we are going through a metamorphic process and a transition, and that does require a lot of stress to be placed on society, on institutions, on models of the current normal, of the current status quo, because the status quo is changing. And if it's changing, you can't hold on to the old stuff. It literally has to die. It has to go. So I think we could be in that process. And so that kind of gives me hope, but it also makes me look at the situation and go, yeah, maybe some more shit's going to have to hit the fan before we're in clearer skies. But I do think that the UFO conversation and other conversations that are taking place at the same time do represent a big shift in how humanity is going to view its place in reality and its own capabilities. And so I'm in this for the long haul, man. I really am. And I'm hopeful, but maybe a little cautious.
Yeah. Yeah, I think so. And I hope so that, that you're right. You know, because
I hope so too, man. I hope so too.
We're either going to make it or we're not. And I think some of these big questions are going to be, you know, crucial to the direction that we go into. But it, you know, it's been great having you on, Jay. I know we got to
cut it,
but, where are people going to be able to find Core Secrets?
It's just going to be on YouTube, guys. I'm just going to be on my channel. Like I said, it's not because of the way in which I'm having to make this, because I want to make it as good as I can. And I'm just one guy and I don't have a film budget. It's not going to be something I'm going to try and profit from, because I am using, you know, some drone shot. Everyone's going to be acknowledged and credited, but I'm using drone shots and things that I'm not capable of getting. And I'm doing that because I want to make it look and feel as good as I can, whilst lacing it in with all the things I've managed to get hold of through my connections and people that have spoken to me. So it's this mix match. You know, I'm not pretending to be making some James Fox style phenomenon documentary where I'm going out and do it, you know, but I do think it's going to be a good example to be able to show people and go, hey, look, watch this and see what you think about the fact that there could be crash retrievals and a deep conversation on this. So I'm hoping that's what it can stimulate. But yeah, it'll be on YouTube. It'll be on my channel. I'll premiere it. I'll announce it beforehand. I'll probably put out another trailer, you know, maybe a couple clips when I'm ready. And then hopefully I can get it out within the next couple of months. I can't guarantee it because, like I said, I'm still waiting on some people to get back to me to contribute their video testimony and their contributions. So it's still being laced together, but I've got a very cohesive idea of where I want to go with it, and I know I can make it look like that. So it's going to happen. It's just a matter of when. But I'll make sure people are informed and know when that's coming. I'll tweet about it. I'll put out promos. And thank you for having me on, dude, to promote it and to talk about it. You know, it's always a pleasure to talk with you, James. And we could talk about so many different areas of this subject, from crash retrievals to consciousness and meditation and psychedelics. Like, you know, that's what I appreciate about you, is you've got the same kind of mind. You're willing to look at all of these different areas. You're fascinated by different things. And I usually learn something from talking with you. It's been a pleasure, as always.
Yeah, greatly appreciated. It's always great having you on. And we're definitely going to be having a lot more talk soon from on this channel, Meta Perspective, your channel. And I'm really looking forward to that, man. So I'll be in touch. And everybody, check the links down below to see, you know, Jay's social media. I'll have another trailer in the description as well. And we'll speak to you soon, Jay. And I think the documentary is going to do awesome. I have a feeling it's going to go big.
I think it's going to help.
So, I know. I think it's going to help a lot of people. And again, I think it's going to be a great project. Like, even a year from now, people are going to discover that film, like, in 1 or 2 years, and be like, holy shit, you know, that's kind of how this stuff happens.
I hope so. Yeah, I hope so. I mean, like, just real quick, I think what's cool is we're in that time period now where you can actually, you know, piece together something just sitting in your room. Like, that's pretty much what I'm doing, is I'll be sitting in my room editing together, and even the interviews and stuff, it's all been through the internet. So it's amazing that we have, you know, if you've got a little bit of talent with editing and a little bit of an idea of how to put something together, you can make something quite compelling. And hopefully that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to make something as compelling as I possibly can, on the restrictions that I do have. But quite frankly, I think it's going to be worthwhile, at least just for me, because I want to do something big and something creative. I just feel like I haven't done that for a while. You know, I love doing the interviews, but there's a part of me that really likes to get into something and kind of create it and put it together. So I hope to inform and entertain, and hopefully it will be something that people will feel like is worth showing to someone to get them to grips with the UFO issue.
Definitely. All right. Thank you so much, Jay. We'll see you soon.
Take care. See you later, dude.